Tennis. And go to today's day. Get your sheet. You may want to flip one the sec back to the second page. Help. So in your text box, what will we put for number one? What is that representing? What's falling out of the sky?
Rain.
What's another word? Precipitation. Always misspell it, so let me look at it. So if you're on the back of the, Caleb, we're doing the attendance. You're looking on this page right here.
I can't get the campus. And honestly, is this there?
No, not yet. Number two. Number two. Look up here where the numbers are. Okay. No, I've got numbers up here on the board. Number two on the board.
Zone.
Hey, Miss Noah.
The back of page two. Each page has a front and back. Number two was zone of variation. It's right up here. All right, number three, what's below the water table? What do we call that? I will, what's on the image?
Underwater table, it says groundwater.
I have numbers up here on this diagram. I want the number that's up here that matches this picture. Number three is over here. It is under the water table, but number three, I have a line up here. Thank you. Saturated zone. You have to do submit assignment. Get the text box. You don't type on it. You just do 1, 2, 3 in the text box. Now, number four, look up here to find where number four is.
Infiltration first, and IBC.
Infiltration. Water table. And then the last one is within the aquifer, we have our ground water. So remember, to get the text box, you have to click submit assignment, then you type these in, and then submit assignment under the text box. We finished groundwater with, so we are, Yeah, that is the last page, but it's the front we got. All right, so we're going to look at what we as humans or population has done to our groundwater. So we should be on the page at hand. At the top, water pollution is the addition of chemicals to natural water. So water pollution is very difficult. It is not supposed to be in with the water in there, and then the water becomes polluted. So what's underlined is there? Chemicals to natural water. More than likely, yeah, but they have regulations they're supposed to follow. All right, sources of water pollution in the United States. Here are some sources. One of them is industrial waste. So any industry, they usually have some type of drainage that ends up in water. Runoff from fields that's treated with, and then in that blank, chemical fertilizers. So we live in a farming area, so we have lots of farm fields. So runoff from that can get into our waterways. And then areas where that have been mined, the runoff from those areas, because they tend to use a lot of water to cool the machinery and things that they use to mine. So those are three possible ones. Yes. Now there are types of pollution. You good, Timothy?
Yep.
All right, so we have two types of pollution. You've got non-point source pollution. So you want the side that the pen is pointing to, because that says non-point source. We'll come back to it. This happened to pop up first. So what is this? It doesn't have a specific point of origin. So if you have a river flowing through here, you may have these developments, city streets, you've got some rural homes, you've got farming, cropland. All of that is kind of going to have some runoff, and it's going to get into that river. And so there's not one particular point that it's entering. It's entering from many different areas, so it's non-point. So you've got atmospheric deposition, precipitation, runoff from land, drainage, seepage. Any of these areas, it's non-point. You can't trace it back to one single source. The examples are all listed here. Maybe not, hold on. Let's see. Here's examples. So you've got storm water runoff. They gave you arsenic from mining and sediment from land. And just so you know, runoff is any water that does not infiltrate into the ground. So if it doesn't soak into the ground, it's considered runoff. So I need to back up Timothy for you. Oh, I guess I skipped point source. When I click on the board, sometimes it goes by two. Now, go to point source because I skipped over that slide. This is contamination that enters through a specific traceable means. So if there's a pipe that's leading through a specific, it's underlined in bullet here, traceable means. So you can trace where that chemical is entering. And it is a point source because you know where it is coming from. You have a specific place. So a sewage pipe or a sewage plant pipe, coal ash ponds are examples. So point source, we know we can identify the culprit to the pollution. Non-point, there's so many things contributing, we can't specifically say what it is. All right. So, next little section, how do we reduce this? We need to work on reducing our pollution because this is all the water we have. And we don't want it all polluted so that we don't have water that we can drink. So fertilizers, use of pesticides, you need to follow the directions of the packages. Oops, that's why I need to not touch, go near that board. Okay. So following directions are important. If you have a septic system, if you live outside the city and you have a septic system, a septic tank, you should have it inspected every 2 to 3 years. Yeah. What? This one?
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't need to change it. That was up. Conserve your sprinkler water. So if you're running water to water grass or running the sprinkler for whatever reason, try to conserve that because that's going to produce runoff. Don't dump anything down a storm drain. So in the city, the big storm drains, a lot of times storm drains actually go into a body of water. And so if you empty that out or if you dump stuff in the storm drain, then you're going to end up contaminating the water source that it's going to. You want to pick up after your pets. Pet waste left on the ground can spread E. coli. Roundworms, salmonella, this stuff could get into the water system as well. So those are some suggestions on how to reduce point and non-point pollution. And point is what? A point is like a dot. Can we identify the source if it's point source? Yes. If it's non-point, we don't know who specifically is contributing. It's a bunch of different factors that play into it. All right, so how exactly is water moving? So we've got North Carolina here, and down here is Pamlico Sound, and you've got two major rivers that flow in that area, the Tar and the Neuse, and they actually are going to flow toward the Pamlico Sound, empty into the Sound, and the Sound of it eventually will, that water will mix with the ocean water through the little inlets in the Outer Banks. All right, so pollutants are going to move through the water supply along the water. So whatever water path it gets in, that's where it's going to go. Maybe a lot of our creeks around here may go to Baden Lake or Lake Tillery. And so it may run, drain there. When Lake Tillery, the dam is released at Lake Tillery, and so when it's polluted, those pollutions are going to travel with the water. And eventually, they're going to lead toward an ocean. So as it moves toward the ocean, it's picking up more pollutants as it goes. So there's going to be more once it gets toward the ocean. It's going to be more concentrated when it empties into the Pamlico Sound, then into the ocean. It's going to have a higher concentration of chemicals because as it flows, it picks up chemicals. Questions on that? Does anybody know of any other river besides PD that's real big in our area?
Rocky.
Thank you. Right, I was like, there was another one. There was another one. I live in Norwood, so PD is the big one there. So PD and Rocky River. All right, so more about our water quality, how we as humans can affect this. So we are having issues with good, clean water to drink. And I shared yesterday, I live in Toledo, and I paid to put it in the house, but I don't use. People don't. Arsenic has gotten into the wells in our rural areas, and so they're trying to get the healthy water out so people can have good, clean water. And so we need to be looking at ways that we can make sure our waters are not being polluted. And as population increases, that means there's going to be less water per person. So that there's not a blank there, but you want to fill that in after an increase in population. So how can we conserve? Four and a half years. We didn't have any water. You had to set a barrel out and capture rainwater. And that was used for bathing and washing dishes. Stuff like that. You bought your drinking water. So water barrels to catch water, and you can use that to water your gardens, your flowers, and so forth. Turning off your faucet so that it's not leaking if it's in or running. And when it starts dripping, you want to get it fixed because that's wasting water. Shorter showers. Also in Haiti, if you wanted water to flow through pipes, you had to have a cistern up on the roof. It was gravity fed, and so you couldn't just let the shower run. You had to turn it on, get yourself wet, turn it off, soap up, turn it on, rinse off. Wasn't long showers and cold showers, by the way. So shorter showers. We take really long showers here. Water rations. So ration out your water. And why would you water plants at night or early in the morning?
Oh,
So it up, but what else would happen if it was during the day? Oh, very good. It will evaporate. So those are just some suggestions on and how we can. Everybody get those?
Yep.
All right. As populations grow rapidly, we have health standards that we have to keep up. And waterborne illnesses. We're lucky. We don't have a lot of this. But last year, it was right before we got out of COVID, when Caleb was here, but you guys weren't. Union County had their water supply got something in it. I can't remember the bacteria that was in it. But they had to not use their water, because if you consumed it, it would give you... mess up your intestines. You'd have what we call the runs. and in Haiti, you couldn't drink the water. You have to buy water. Cholera, dysentery, I think some other things that were in there. A lot of other things like in the water, like just it walking in the rivers and things. If you have an opening, you could get parasites that could enter your feet. So water, good clean water is really a privilege that we, I think, take for granted here. So wastewater treatment plants. We have one of these in Albemarle. And so what it does is if you live in the city, it brings in all your water. And I believe it's even sewage as well. I don't know if they're two different ones. I can't. I'm trying to remember. My dad used to work the one in Norwood. But they treat it. And so it may not be treated at the same place, but these bins here are going to be filled with sand and things that's going to allow the water to filter. And it's going to filter out all the bad stuff. And then it's going to go through other filtering processes. And it's going to keep all the solids, going to remove anything that's suspended from it, and then it's going to treat the water, filter out more. City water usually has like a chlorinated type taste. They're going to add that, add fluorine in it, and then it comes out to us. But that's real important for our treating. So wastewater, I believe, also includes like the sewage, like in the city. So it is actually, the water is taken from that and treated. Don't know exactly how, because I'm a septic tank person right here. Well, no, this is not septic. This is a drainage. All right, so drinking water treatment systems. I am... I grew up on well water and still use well water, but in around here you will see water towers. So from the water treatment plant, they'll pump out the water to the water tower, and then it will, this gravity fed when it comes out. But notice all these places where it's being filtered, it just always has some type of sand and rocks there to help filter it. So it's going to have to go somewhere where coagulation, that means all the solid pieces are going to be grouped together, clumped together, and so they can be filtered out. It's going to go through more filtering, sedimentation. It's going to sit there, and when some water sits, anything that's in it is going to settle to the bottom. Then it's going to go through more filtration, and it's going to be disinfected, and it's going to be kept in some type of storage. And around here, you'll see the water towers. Typhoid is the other one I was thinking about. You can get cholera, typhoid, even hepatitis A, food poisoning, all from bacteria that can get into your water. And we're lucky in that we don't have typhoid or cholera here because of the treatment plants that we have. We don't need a computer right now. You're supposed to be doing this. Let them all in. This?
Yeah.
We just did this. All right, so questions. All right, here's options. What happens Friday? Friday is November the 20th. Why is that day important? What can you not do after November 20th? It was in the announcements that went out. From the beginning of this quarter through tomorrow. Okay? So, if you will look or go to your grades, I can't pull grades up here because it'll show everybody's. But you want to, anything that's out of 0 points is extra credit. So if it says a zero, okay, those are extra credit. All your tickets, this is extra credit. These are our warm-ups. And if you do it, it's points that will help you, okay? So if you're all caught up, what you need to work on the groundwater contamination from last Friday. If you are not caught up, you need to go into grades and you need to start working on, I'm giving you time because we're at a point that is good to do this, to get any material made up with my hair here. If I good. See if it's out of 0 points here, don't worry about it. If it's 0 here, you don't. So, see, I have to grade it. So, if you're caught up, I'm going to let you know to grade that. And so then you just have to work on it. Okay. Hang caught up. You need to go home and think your mom. That's why I want to
take it.
And the Portland West groundwater commission. That was going to be my second part.
Thank you.